Hello, Chris Menard here. Great video today. We're going to discuss what is market capitalization, how to use Excel to figure out the market capitalization of different companies and why you would want to know that. And we're going to have a little bit of fun taking a look at this year's S&P return, which has been around 15% over the past 6 months. And we're going to look what happens if you took that and ran it out for 20 years. Just to show you what the number is. So let's dive in right now. Item number one, what is market capitalization? You take the number of outstanding shares that a company has and you multiply it times the share price, and that is your market capitalization for a company. As an example, if a company had 1 million shares outstanding and they were selling for $48, that would be $48 million is their market capitalization. The financial people like to break this out into large, medium, and small. A company that's in a large market cap is over $10 billion. Medium is $2 billion up to $10 billion. And then we have small cap, that would be $250 million up to the $2 billion. Now, let's crank up Excel and use one of my favorite features in Excel. We're going to look at some stock analysis and figure out what are companies' market capitalizations. I have Excel running. You can do this with me if you have M365 for sure. You can always use the web version. I'm going to type in the word stock in A1. I happen to know that some of the largest companies with the highest market capitalization, I'm taking a guess here, we're going to see Microsoft, Apple, definitely NVIDIA now. Google should be in there, which is Alphabet. Alphabet owns Google. But I want to add some other companies that aren't quite as large. So here we go. Microsoft, Apple. Let's put in Tesla. You can add whatever companies you want. I want to do Delta Airlines. I'm based in Atlanta, and I usually fly Delta, which is headquarters here. Let's put in a couple other companies. Alphabet. All right. Not required, but go ahead and make stock bold. That is your header row. And the item I definitely want to do, please make this a table. It'll be so much easier. Control T, click OK, and now it's a table. The reason you wanted to make it a table is we're going to change all these companies to the data type of stock, because right now this is just text. Microsoft's text, Apple's text. So let me highlight these companies. Let's go to the data tab, and here's our data types. There is the stock data type. It should convert it. Make sure you have an internet connection when you're doing this or it will not work. I'm going to widen that column. So it looked like it picked up Microsoft MSFT. That is their stock price. Apple, yep, that works. Alphabet, I'm going to click on it. Alphabet is interesting. Alphabet has two different shares of stock. One is voting, and the other one, if you purchase it, you don't get voting rights. I believe the GL is the voting. Let's just pick this one. There we go. And Tesla didn't pick up. Let me just go find Tesla's stock symbol and type it in here. Tesla's stock symbol is TSLA. There you go. Let's add NVIDIA too. NVDA is their stock symbol, and there we go. All right, so if you notice, the reason we made it a table is if I added additional companies, it's automatically picking up the companies. If I had a range, it probably would not. The other reason is because I have a table, and I've made this the stock symbol data type. When I click here, it says add column. I would like to know, let's take a look at what we have here. I do want to know what's the 52-week high. When I click it, B1 has 52-week high. If this was a range, B1 would be empty and you wouldn't know what this is. Let's do the 52-week low. Perfect. There we go. And here we go. I want to know what is their market cap. Right there is that field. Microsoft, NVIDIA. I know that they're going to be up here with the highest market caps. Let's see if I'm right. Definitely need to widen this column. So there we go. Yes, that is $3 trillion, $3.3 trillion for Microsoft. Look at NVIDIA down there, 3.1. Apple is probably third. Alphabet, yep, $2 trillion. So those are definitely large cap stocks right there. Let's put in someone that I believe is not going to be large. And just because you're not large doesn't mean good or bad. There are index funds that invest in small cap. There are index funds that invest in mid cap. You probably have seen these on your 401k when you get to go pick your investments. These different funds invest in different companies, and some invest in large, some medium, some small. Let's see if JetBlue shows up here. Perfect. So JetBlue, because it's just under two, would fall in the medium category right there for you, by the way. All right, let's see what else we have in here. Just a couple other items. Oh, there's headquarters. That's pretty good. Let's go see what the price is. Today is Saturday, June 22nd, 2024. So previous close, that should be yesterday's date. Right there. What else do we have in here? Shares outstanding, right there. So take the price times the shares outstanding, and that should end up being your market cap. If it's a tad off, I'm sure there's something going on here in the background, because you can still purchase shares on the weekend, even off hours. So the transactions happen, though, next time the stock market opens, just to be clear about that. All right, so there's some valuable information for you. This is a great Excel feature. I really love this. So now I want to go and have a little bit of fun, and we pull this up. So this is for the current year. This is the S&P 500, and I'm going to go year to date. And again, today is Saturday, June 22nd. So it's having the last day closing is Friday, June 21st, which is correct. Notice it closed at 5,464. Where did it start off at? I'm mousing over here, 4,742. I've already done the math. This is over a 15% increase from January 1 through the closing of yesterday. So I wanted to have a little bit of fun and say, okay, hypothetically, there's no guarantee of this. What if we continued on with this trend for this year, 2024, and we ended up with over a 30% increase? You don't always get that. We actually have had a 30% increase. I think it was about a decade ago. We hit over 30%. Last year, I believe we did 24%. The S&P increased 24%. And if you go back to 1954, when the S&P was still S&P was already running, by the way, I think we were around 45% increase for the year. So you can have really high increases for the year. And just to be clear, you could also definitely have negative returns. 2000, 2001, 2002, I think those were three straight years back to back of negative returns. Then we got into a bunch of positive, and then the housing market in 2008 gave us a huge negative return also. But I went and looked at this, 73% of the time, and the S&P has been around for a long time, you have positive returns. So anyway, back to Excel, just to show you this. This is some cool features. Let me go to sheet one. There's large, medium, and small. I have some rows hidden here. I'm going back to what would happen if we actually got 30%, and I'm making this up. This isn't going to happen, but I was just curious. What if we got 30% every year? And what if we invested initially $10,000 and then we never put another dime into it? We just let it grow. Well, 30% of 10,000 is 13. 30% of the 13 is this. This is that compounded interest kicking in, which is just a great feature in life. Year one, year two. So I ran it out for 20 years. Look at this. You would have almost $2 million. That's not going to happen, by the way. You're not going to get 30% every year, but it's fun to play with these numbers. So is there another function I could have used? There is the future value function in Excel. What is the rate? 0.3. I did 0.30. It doesn't matter. Comma. Number of periods will be 20 years. Comma. Are you contributing money every year? No, we're not. So this is going to be blank. I'm going to do another comma. And then how much money are you putting in right now? I did a negative 10,000 because I want to see the numbers are positive. You could have not left the negative out. This is it. I should. My fingers are crossed. I better get the exact same number I've got in cell D21. Let's see if this is true. I do. 1900496. So there you go. $2 million. Anyway, so you can come and play with this. You're going to get, historically, you're going to get between 9 to 10.5%, depending on what data you look at for the S&P 500. Here's 9%. $10,000. Don't touch it. I can tell you this. The rule of 72 is another video that I have. If I knew that I was getting 9% on average, you take the 9%, you divide it into 72, that is 8 years. That means every 8 years, your money will double according to the rule of 72. Let's see if that is true. It's not going to be exact, but there you go. $10,000 turned into almost $20,000. I'm rounding, in 8 years. That is the rule 72. If this was 8%, so now we're looking at 9 years. Let's see if this is true. Yep, there's your 9 years. So that is the rule of 72 for you. My video on that will be in the description along with my other personal finance videos. Oh, one last thing I got to tell you. I forgot about this. I wanted to mention this. The S&P 500 actually has more than 500 stocks. I believe there's 503. Because there are certain companies like Alphabet, they've got two different shares of stock. We saw this a second ago. They've got the voting and then they have the non-voting. So if I go and put in GOOG, that one is the non-voting one. I don't care that the 52-week high and the 52-week low are different. What I better see, and this is what I was wanting to see, their market cap better be exactly the same, and it is. So that is their market capitalization right there. This is a Chris Menard theory. The GOOG is the non-voting one, and I'm actually a little surprised that, let's go look at the price right here, 176, 170. The price is actually less for the voting one. Usually the price is more for the voting one. My theory is this, is that Google may be buying back shares. It's called a stock buyback of the GOOG. We're not covering stock buybacks here, but they're basically buying back some of the shares of outstanding stock. And that's why that price is actually higher than the voting shares, which is the GL. Real quick, if you add that price column, because it was bothering me, I want numbers to be exact. If you add that price column to your table and you take the price column times the outstanding shares, 3342, 3342, 902, I auto-filled that down and we are getting a match on most of these. So it is the, just to prove that it was the price times the outstanding shares for you. Hope you enjoyed this video. I went a little long. Feel free to subscribe and ring the bell. My Excel online training classes are available along with Teams, OneNote, Copilot. Have a great day. Thanks.